Welcome to the latest edition of the Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN, the first one for 2021. I think this is the first podcast for 2021, and I have got a great guest for you. I am joined in episode number 6 by Last Minute Wrestling's own Frank Mandolini. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, I am doing, as always, the RVD hand gesture because I'm a goof and I always do that because it gives me confidence, you know, to do like Frank Mandolini and you do the hand gesture meanwhile. So, yeah, that's a great start.
It's almost like you've spoken to the man before, but we'll get on to that, I'm sure.
Yeah.
So, for those who are unaware, who haven't listened to Frank Mandolini's Last Minute Wrestling podcast, which you should have by now, episode number 6 was speaking to me, which is quite a nice way of putting, this is number 6 of Untitled Wrestling Podcast, and I'm speaking to you. So that's just how it's worked out. It's,
Billy, we came full circle.
I know, it's very strange. I mean, I don't know how, I think I contacted you maybe, you're looking for people to speak to, and I ended up, Paxo, I suppose, was got you into the, looking to Patsy, got you into the Scottish wrestling scene, and I've kind of thrusted you into the rest of it. We'll go back to start, though. How did you get into pro wrestling?
Oh, that's a great question, because I actually don't know the answer to it. I've had the chance to talk a little bit about it, even on my podcast as well, because mainly Italy had three main periods of mainstream wrestling in national television. The first time around was around like 1990, more or less. I was 3 years old back then, so I recall something from television, like a yellow man or something like that, which probably was Hulk Hogan. and yellow, I mean the color of the trunks, of course, I remember that vividly. And the Ultimate Warrior, I had a figure, an action figure of the Ultimate Warrior, the one that you pushed on the back and it did like a gorilla press or something like that. It was a pretty common one. But I wouldn't say that my fandom started back there. I have those memories, but like the... Nothing else for close to 10 years when I had the chance to see a little bit of the late WCW was on the national TV in Italy at the time. I remember Goldberg and I think Bobby the Brain Heenan was there as well, roughly around 99, 2000. But my true introduction to wrestling was a few years later in 2004 when that was during the summer, but it's weird because during that summer I had the chance to see the Royal Rumble of 2004, which was in January, as of course everybody knows.
And we don't know who won it. Nobody knows.
Yeah, the man who shall not be named won it. And from what I can recall from that point onward, I was hooked. And basically after that, a friend of mine had SmackDown Here Comes the Pain, which is the greatest wrestling video game of all time. Fight me. if you don't agree with that. Not you, Billy. I mean... the listeners.
Sorry, I was because I'm going to say shut your mouth was just tipped it for me personally, but it's their own.
But just like everything in wrestling, probably we think that like the best thing ever is the thing that got us into wrestling. My favorite period of wrestling is the Ruthless Aggression era, because basically that's the first knowledge I had about it. Whenever I get a chance to see something from the Attitude Era, which I totally didn't see live at the time, to me it's just, it's kind of boring, actually, in my opinion. I liked, we had SmackDown here in Italy, and the SmackDown 6 were everything. Like, give me Kurt Angle, Los Guerreros, both Eddie and Chavo, because he is always overlooked, but he is an amazing talent. Even at the time, even JBL was interesting when he was the world champion. JBL and the Basham brothers, even, for God's sake, even Orlando Jordan was interesting. They were able to make it cool in some ways. Well, not cool, but you wanted to see him getting his ass kicked. So that's that was amazing. That was an amazing period for SmackDown, and nothing else comes close to me when it comes to like being a fan in the real meaning of the word. Now I know much, much more about wrestling than what I knew back then. I appreciate many different aspects of wrestling. I understand more the technique that goes on when the two wrestlers have to put up a match, the narrative standpoint of what they're trying to do. I like even the production value of the people who are actually shooting that, because sometimes you have great camera work, sometimes you have shitty camera work, and you know, it's those kind of things that us marks in 2020 or 2021, I should say, are looking for at the moment, which is totally not what I was looking for at the time in 2004, 2005, roughly.
Absolutely. I'm in total agreement with you. It's like what you started watching, that's what you remember as being the best. Because I started 98, 99 is what I remember uh-huh. first seeing, but 2000, 2001, that's when I was proper into it. So 2000 had a fantastic run of shows. 2001, it led into WrestleMania 17. So it's a huge time for the wrestling business in general, but for me it's just like that nostalgia kick. I'll go back now and watch Raws from 2001 and into the Invasion. I love the Invasion. I don't care if you're fighting people, and here comes the pain. I'm fighting people for the Invasion. I loved it, because my only experience WCW was Worldwide, and it was on Channel 5 for an hour. And it had the big Batman clangs and bangs if they got hit by in the head or chairs. So
yeah.
All these guys coming in, Sean O'Hare and your Chuck Palumbos, and even Sean Stasiak. It was still blowing my mind that I was seeing all these new guys. They were shit in the most part, but but it was still blowing my mind to see Chronic, because I remember Chronic from Thunder, and I was like, oh my god, it's Chronic, and then I watched shows, and I'm like, oh god, it's Chronic. But still, it's just that blew my mind. But yeah, SmackDown 6, fantastic time for wrestling. Even moving into that, just into the just the little period afterwards, my first WWE show live was 2006. So it was just after that, and it was DX and Rated RKO and
But it was still probably considered the Ruthless Aggression era, right?
Say so, yeah. I think. Yeah. So what would we say? I think 2000, maybe 2008 or 2009 it started moving
to the PG. Yeah. I think it went PG in 2008, if I recall correctly. So which is considered like, you know, the next era. And yeah, I would say Ruthless Aggression is roughly from 2002 to 2008-ish.
I would say so. Yeah, I'm in agreement with you there. So it went from 2004, still watching wrestling now, of course. But who are your favorites growing up there? You had SmackDown 6. Was there anyone else that caught your eye? Any random ones like Tajiri?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I love Tajiri. I absolutely love Tajiri. There is one of my favorite match of that era. Well, of course, basically all of my favorite matches of that era involve a certain someone that shall not be named. There is a match, not on SmackDown, that was on Raw. And it was probably 2005, I think, probably. I don't know. No, well, probably late 2004. Tajiri against the man that nobody can name anymore. And that was an amazing match.
Was that the hardcore match, if I remember off the top of my head?
Yeah, it was, because I was about to say, that was, I think, a throwback to the ECW time. It was probably a couple of months before that they did the first One Night Stand, the first ECW One Night Stand.
Yep.
So I correct myself, early 2005, probably. Because they wanted to, like, reenact with some ECW originals, and both of them were, Loptaju is the man. He's the man, totally. Now he's still killing it in old Japan.
Yes, we used to come back for the, like, the Cruiserweight Classic when that was on. You're just thinking,
how are
you still doing that? And still so well. But no, Tajiri is one of those. For me, I like underrated heroes. That's why one of my favorites. So I met Scotty Tuhati. I blew my mind.
Because
Scotty was one of my guys growing up. Not just because he had the same birthday as me. Obviously different years. I'm a lot younger than him. But same day.
You know who has the same birthday as me? Because of course I checked. You know who? The poor late Ashley Massaro.
Nice.
We were born on the same day. She was 10 years older than me, if I recall correctly. But I was a huge fan of her. For example, what I was talking about before, back then nobody, at least in my circle, nobody cared about work rate or all this kind of bullshit that now divides a lot of wrestling fans, in my opinion. She was never the greatest worker, but she had a couple of intriguing storylines, and they made that work. And you don't have to be like about the greatest athlete in the ring. You have to be an elite storyteller, which is a whole different animal.
Absolutely.
If you compare, if I jump like from different topics, but. If you compare, like, Bruiser Brody, somebody who was an incredible character who drew millions of dollars and yens as well, because he was very famous in Japan. Is Bruiser Brody more athletic than even a Rey Mysterio? No. No, not at all. More athletic than... Kenny Omega, the Young Bucks, Kota Ibushi, Okada, whoever you want to name. Of course not. Of course not. But that was not the point of his persona. And that's what I feel today is missing in wrestling, which wasn't your question at the beginning. Sorry.
Absolutely fine. I'm actually totally agree with you. We're going to have a good time. We're totally agreeing with pretty much a lot of things.
Yeah.
But, when you speak about, I mean, British wrestling, your two biggest stars are Big Daddy and Giant Haystacks.
Yeah.
Fuck all. They had no moves. They just ran at each other for a bit. And then Haystacks fell out. 90,000 people going absolutely mental for it. And there was no wrestling. No, there's just moments and moves. And I think we're going to go all over the place. But that's always my criticism of NXT UK right now is they have fantastic wrestlers, great wrestlers of all over the world, all over Europe, but they don't have that character. They don't have, like, back NXT when it was kind of at its peak, had No Way Jose.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't have to wrestle much, but it was entertaining. Yeah. They had Eric Bugenhausen, was it Bugenhausen? He did the air guitar.
Yeah, they did the air guitar, yeah.
He was there for 2 weeks, best thing on the show, gone. There needs to be that. Even though that there's no fans or anyone, there needs to be someone to grab the crowd from the TV, like Drew does, I think, even though Raw's ratings are...
Oh, yeah.
But Drew looks into the camera. He brings the crowd with him at the same time. Yeah. So that's why I'm always like, oh, no, NXT should get this. Should get Kreiger, who you've spoken to. They should get Luke King Sharp. Yeah. They should get Grado. I mean, they probably wouldn't get Grado because Grado's, like, super busy everywhere. But They need someone who's a character and will maybe make an arse of themselves, but will do it for the entertainment in general. So I don't think I've even answered the question I started asking you. So
But we are still talking. So I want to add just a little thing that still doesn't answer your question, but who cares at this point, right?
Exactly.
I think that something that wrestling fans completely miss at this in this era is that every wrestler has to have its role, which it doesn't mean that you're a jobber, curtain jerker, or a main eventer. It's simply different roles. For example, you named Drew McIntyre. He is absolutely fantastic. He's been killing it throughout all of 2020, and of course, even before in his career, but I'm talking in most recent times as a WWE champion. Is amazing, and he has played his role to perfection. His role is that the guy who doesn't take any bullshit, any crap, he will kick your face in, and he's not afraid to do that, and he looks cool while doing it. I mean, that's amazing. On the contrary, you have somebody like, I don't know, Otis, which I'm not a great fan of, but I think that he is another guy who understands his role, and he is playing it to perfection, probably. You may not be, the public may not be super into it. I get it. I get why, because somebody wants to cheer for the superhero like Drew, for example, because he's cool, he's a badass. Everybody wants to be that. But you need a moment of levity in the card as well, because a wrestling show is not about being a super worker all the time, at least in my opinion. You have to have like those flows, you know, the different levels of intensity throughout the show. And that's something that particularly in the last 5 years, I would say, sort of disappeared from mainstream wrestling in general. Because if you think about it at the moment, like half of the wrestlers, their gimmick is to be a very great wrestler. That's their gimmick. Ricochet. Please somebody tell me what's Ricochet's gimmick.
He's just a very good wrestler.
He's an incredible talent, but in that stage of WWE, you need to do something else. It's not only the athletic ability that counts. You have to be able to insert yourself in something else.
Exactly. So when you were watching it, when around about 2004, 2005, if you looked at any random card, you'd have your main eventers, of course. In 2005, you'd have Shawn Michaels, Triple H, at that point, John Cena. And then you'd have just underneath them guys like Chris Jericho, Edge.
Kane.
Yes, absolutely. And then you'd have guys like Hurricane. And you'd have these exceptional characters down the bottom that are amazing. I mean, I hated Eugene, but for what he was an incredible character.
He was an incredible character, yes.
So you had all that going on. Then you had like Kurt Angle swinging in between. But it's just, I think for some reason, Ruthless Aggression doesn't get as much respect. I think it's because on the Raw side of things, it was due to this Triple H time of him overtaking everything. But
the Reign of Terror.
Reign of Terror, that's the words. But when you go back and watch it, there's a lot of good stuff. I liked Test during that time.
Oh, yeah.
Of all people.
Yeah.
Test. Because he was huge. I mean, well, for the wrong reasons. But he was huge. He was pretty decent in the ring. He had a character. He had the testicles, which I found hilarious because I was 15. And anything that was penis-related was hilarious. I mean, I'm 30 now. And I'd probably still laugh if I saw testicles on a t-shirt.
Me too, totally.
But yeah, so wrestling this now is missing. It's missing characters, and like we're saying with people willing to make a tit of themselves, make an arse of themselves, and not be as serious, and just go. I'm just here to entertain. I'm an alright wrestler. I can do the job if I need to, but Hulk Hogan could do arm bars and all the Fujiwara Japanese stuff. Did he have to? Did he fuck? All he had to do was big boot and leg drop and he was done.
Yeah, and a lot of posing. Yeah, that's it. That's it. But, I mean, you have to do what works with the crowd and what specifically what the show needs. I mean, if you have the chance to play in an Oscar-winning Hollywood movie, would you bitch if you're not the protagonist or not? Or would you be happy to have even like a small role, you say a couple of lines and that's it? I mean, you will still brag that you were inside that movie, right? And with wrestling, it should be the same. It should be the same. You work for the biggest company in the world. You have to understand that there are different levels, different characters playing, and you're just one of them. And you have to do your work to perfection.
Exactly. Yes. And you've got to be prepared. So, I mean, it could be a case like, I don't think people are prepared. Like Otis being the example you brought up, someone who's great at what he does. Again, not my particular cup of tea, which is strange because he's weird and that's my usual my cup of tea. But I don't think he was ready just to be that top bit, but he was that weird. He was like hanging that line between he could, but I don't think he was nurtured enough to make it. I don't know. We're wildly off topic because I asked you who your favorite wrestlers were when growing up, and this is how we've gotten. We're trying to fix the wrestling business instead. Right. So when we first spoke, it was episode 6 of your podcast. You have discussed with Ringsiders on your own podcast. I think it was episode 30, was it? Or it was one of your milestone ones.
40.
You were speaking about how you got into podcasting. For those that are unaware, or if you want to do a little bit of a cliff note version, how did you get into doing the podcasting?
Okay, that's a great question. I've been wanting to do a wrestling podcast since around WrestleMania 30, when Daniel Bryan won he was the unified. How was that called? I don't even remember that. I mean, he won both of the championships against Batista and Randy Orton. And I had been wanting to do that, but I didn't know that it was possible to do that through a podcast, because at the time I was thinking mainly about a YouTube channel, but I didn't want to appear in front of the camera, which sort of I still don't want to do that today as well. I mean, at least not with the precision level that YouTube requires. I don't have time to spend editing massively those videos, because they have to be an incredibly high quality. You have to pace it each 8 seconds. You have to change the setup of the camera. Well, it's too much work. So I didn't want to do the YouTube version, but I always had this idea in the back of my mind. And this year during the pandemic, 2 days before WrestleMania 36, so 6 years after I started thinking about that, I woke up and I said to my fiance, which we was still sleeping probably, I woke up and I said, fuck it, I'm recording a podcast today. She was like, what? And I was like, yeah, I'm going to do it. Okay, how are you going to call it? This is pretty last minute, so it's going to be last minute wrestling podcast. That's it. That's how it started, which is a name that I hated in the beginning, but now it's growing on me. Even because a lot of the wrestling podcasts I see around have wrestling related names, like the SmackDown versus Raw, or the Hip Toss, or the DDT podcast, or something like that, you know. And when I think about it, mine doesn't have a wrestling related name. I mean, Last Minute can be everything, right? So plus, that's the word wrestling, so people know what I'm talking about. But I kind of like it now. So, but yeah, that's actually how it started. And it's from a working perspective, it's a very good way to increase your skills, especially if, like me, you work in communication, because it's a tremendous medium at the moment that, as you know, of course, as well, it's growing in a huge way all over the world. And it has been actually I read a couple of articles about it. It has been declared that podcasting was the main medium of 2020, because well, a lot of people were stuck in their homes and they started a podcast, basically, just like me, just like I did.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of dabbled again after speaking to yourself. So for anyone that's watching or listening to this, it's Frank's fault. But I dabbled in it before, previously, but I didn't know how to do it. At times I had a little tape recorder and I was speaking to people on the phone. And I was just having the recorder next to the phone. I would speak to people after shows, but I've always felt like if I'm pestering you at a show, you want to go, the wrestler wants to go home. I want to go home. So I'm only speaking to them for about 5 minutes. It just sounds a bit shit. And interviewing and speaking to people, I mean, my job is customer services. I want to speak to people for as little as possible most of the time. So just speaking to people, I find very much outside my comfort zone. But after speaking to yourself, and I thought, you know what, I'll have a look into it. Zoom seems fairly straightforward to use. And then I did the first one with Omar Muhammad, who spoke for half an hour. I asked only wrestling questions, and then it somehow spun off from there, where I think the next episode was Kevin Williams, and there was my dog decided she wanted to play with the squeakiest toy in the world. Our ice cream van turned up halfway through. We ended up getting into a very long conversation about dinosaurs, and I thought, right, okay, it's still going to be a wrestling podcast, but it's spinning out of control very quickly. So it's now just what I do when my wife's working nights. So she leaves for the day, and I'm like, right, I'm speaking to someone tonight, so they can deal with me if I've spent the whole day bored, and just off my nut. So your first interview was with Pax, with Luca De Pazzi, Paxo. Yeah. Yes. So I mean, that's always a fellow Italian as well, which is handy. How did it get set up with you speaking to Luca? We'll call him Luca.
you mean how did I have the idea to interview him, or
because your first few podcasts were reviews, weren't they? Reviews and previews and speaking about wrestling, and then you went into interviews. How did you transition from just doing the reviews and then contacting Luca and setting up an interview?
Oh, probably it was because of Twitter. I had previously in my life, I had a Twitter account, a personal one that I almost never used. And it lasted close to 10 years. So in 10 years, I had like, I don't know, 200 tweets or something like that. I decided to close it, to shut it down. And when I started the podcast, I knew that the wrestling world moved mainly via Twitter. So I said, okay, I have to set up a Twitter account. And I did it reluctantly, because since I work in communication, I fucking hate social media, and I want to try to stay away from it as far as possible, at least from a personal point of view. But then I started using Twitter, and because of the podcast. At the very beginning, I wanted to do, as you said, wrestling reviews, but I think those were kind of shit. I mean, I put so much effort into it, but I learned immediately that it's much more difficult to be interesting talking with a microphone alone in your spare room than when you're talking to the microphone, but you have another person on the other hand. So I said, okay, well, this is clearly not working the way I wanted to. So I started to dig a little bit more on social media. And I said, okay, which are the wrestling promotions that I know in Europe? And ICW was one of the first one that came to mind, probably. And probably just by clicking here and there, you know the social media give you some suggestion of according to your likes and stuff like that, or who do you follow. And this guy, Luca De Pazzi, came out. I didn't know him. I didn't know about Italian wrestling. I wouldn't say one bit, but yeah, more or less. I didn't know very much about Italian wrestling. And I actually thought he wasn't Italian. I thought it was a Scottish guy playing an Italian guy. And I started following him. And I followed Joki as well. Ivil. He is his girlfriend, which is also an amazing wrestler, which I didn't know, of course.
Yeah.
which I didn't know at the time. And basically, I asked both of them to be in an interview, to be a guest on the show. And I was like, well, I just started this show, which is kind of crap, but I would like to kind of improve it and start doing some interviews. He was the quicker to answer, basically. That's why I got him before Joki. In all seriousness, that was a blessing, a total blessing. I am Luca is probably one of the person that I talk the most in my day-to-day life nowadays. I really found an important person for me, and he was the one that basically introduced me to both Italian and Scottish wrestling. Well, of course you did an amazing job as well, because right next up there was the interview that we recorded, so that helped me going even deeper into that.
I'll dive it. If anyone wants to speak to me about Scottish wrestling, I will just dive into a rabbit hole. So that's why I'll make my own podcast instead. That's probably safer.
Yeah, and you were also so important, because you not only you mentioned a few wrestlers that you already liked. For example, Sarah Marie Taylor, is that correct name?
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Sorry, because I am awful with names, so I hope I get the names right. But also, you introduced to me even up-and-comers or people that weren't that famous, even in the Scottish indie scene to begin with. And I had the chance to see some of those talents, to interview them, and that was amazing, because it was even, I don't know, another degree further to analyze the indie wrestling in Europe. Of course, it wasn't just the biggest federations that already are existing in Europe, also other ones. For example, you told me about WrestleZone, which I remember. I checked their YouTube. I checked a few matches. That was fun. That was interesting to know a little more. I don't know if I answered your question, but
no idea. It's fine. So, what's your process for doing an interview then? Because I know when I started, I mean, I've got an approximate knowledge of pretty much most of Scottish wrestling, as I know just about enough to get by. So I didn't write notes which was a stupid idea. I didn't write any notes. I had nothing at all. I had a blank bit of paper just in case they had mentioned something. Oh, don't mention so-and-so. That's fine. I'll write that down. It took to my interview with Sarah Marie Taylor, who you mentioned, which is...
Yep.
I interviewed her and I just bombed it. She was fantastic. She was lovely. She answered my questions. But as soon as I started speaking to her, my mind just went, gone. I had nothing in my head. And from that point onwards, I even for yourself, I've got 4 bullet points. That's enough for me. At least I have something to go with. Yeah. But before I had nothing. So what's your process? I mean, especially when you're speaking to guys like Luca, like Ian Skinner, who has a question, which we'll get to in a second. What's your process with getting your information to speak to these people?
I don't. I simply don't get my information, and I try to, I go with the flow, probably, and that's exactly how I've always approached even my journalism career, because before I said I work in communication, but I am a journalist. I've been doing that for more than 10 years now. I trained both in Italy and in England. And if you're wondering, no, that's not why I speak English so well for an Italian. But even in journalism, I never prepare before an interview. I had the chance to interview very important politicians, singers, actors, stuff like that. Never once I prepared the question beforehand. I don't know if it's a gift or if I'm just stupid for not doing my researches. I mean, I do my researches. I generally know the people at least a little bit about what they are doing in their life, because that's what you gotta do. But I feel that, especially in podcasting, I feel that whatever comes naturally, even if it's not probably the best road that you could take, it's much better. It sounds better. It sounds more natural. And the listener will hear that. That's why I generally don't prepare anything. Not even one of my interviews had like bullet points or like the questions were like handed beforehand to the people I was interviewing.
I suppose that being especially for your podcast, and that'll be down to your experience then. I mean, you've done it for 10 years. I mean, you said you've done it right from the start. You didn't do any notes, but at this point, you're thinking 10 years down the line, you must be pretty good at it, of just going on the fly. I mean, for myself, I properly only started podcasting this year. So, I mean, even my interviews, if you go to the website, they are fairly generic questions, because I'm just like, it's just not, I'm not naturally a speaking person. That's why I like Zoom, because if the conversation's over, I just hit end of conversation and I'm gone. If it's real life, if I'm speaking to someone face-to-face, it gets awkward very quickly. Because I just like having a minute to think. But that minute to think is the longest minute in the world. One thing on our question. But like with Zoom, I can act like an absolute tit. And at the end of the day, we're not face-to-face. So it works. It's fine. It works in my head. I don't know if it actually works in real life. If anyone's just watching these or listening to these going... He's a bit scatterbrained. So for your, we'll speak about Ian Skinner for a second, just because he's the first one that we put in a question. But his question was just, how did you find out about him? So how did you find out about Ian Skinner? I think we know, but answer it.
That's a very famous story. I scouted him when he was 5 years old. I was at his kindergarten where he was doing some flips and kicks to the other children, and that's how I said, okay, let's interview this guy like some 20 years down the line. That's basically what I did. Is that the answer you were waiting for?
I mean, it's nice to know there was someone else in the same day. I don't feel so creepy now when I was watching a five-year-old doing flips and kicks.
No. Well, some guy named Billy Strachan from the Scottish Wrestling Network told me about Ian Skinner to keep an eye on him because he was doing amazing things, not only in the ring, but also on social media. Was very entertaining. And I agree. Ian Skinner is very entertaining on social media as well. So that's how I got to know about him. But with that being said, as I always say, in 10 years' time, I will brag that I discovered him and I will deny this story. I will
deny. Yeah, Ian Skinner, he's so much younger than me. When I interviewed him, he just made me feel old. He didn't mean to, but just with all these memes and references, I was just sitting there going, I have no idea what you're on about. And he contacted me going, oh, let's do a second one. I'm just like, yeah, sure. I have no idea what you're going to speak about, though, because it'll be all the young people things. And I'll be sitting there going, I don't know what you're speaking about. I just don't. But anyway, right. So, yeah, Ian Skinner, there's your shout-out. There's your story. I'm sure you're listening. Sign up to the Patreon. You can see the video. Quote the other questions. We'll pick and choose. Oh, hang on. Brody Adler's asked, how did you find out about Ian Skinner? So that's fine. That's that one. That's
that I already one answered that.
Yeah, so that's fine. So another one, you haven't actually interviewed him directly, but Brent Carter, you have quite a... I was speaking about your social media presence. You said you hated it. You hated social media.
Yeah.
You're very good at the Twitter. You're very good at engaging people in conversation. So again, that's just your background for communications, I'm guessing. Just... It's a skill that you're stuck with, unfortunately. Just being good at socializing.
Yeah, that's my
your burden.
My burden, exactly. I'm damned to be good at that. No, well, Twitter is a strange animal. I discovered that a lot of it is connected to circumstances. I mean, you have to pick really the exact moment to send out a tweet. The same tweet can be very difficult, very different from morning to noon or to the evening. Like, you have to pick the exact same time. And if you really don't give a fuck about what you're saying, because that's another secret, you don't have to give a fuck. Every time you try and think about the perfect tweet, that will never work. At least in my experience, that really rarely worked. And if it worked, it worked much less than when than the other time that you just said, "Oh fuck it, I just write that, I just tweet it." And really, if you don't give a fuck, if you stop caring, Twitter will work. That's weird to say, you know, but in my opinion, that's exactly what's going on.
I know, and you can't really be down about it as well. I mean, I personally made myself absolutely end myself on a joke about AJ Styles that I got nothing, got no likes, got no retweets, but I was like, fuck it. I was sending that out because it made me laugh, and it was just a flat earth joke about AJ Styles wrestling. He's wrestled across the world and beating everyone. And for me, I was a flat earth joke. I thought, that's fucking hilarious. No likes. you don't know comedy Twitter. Fuck you. but no, I like to just put out little tweets now during the Thunderdome shows and pay-per-views because, yeah, for the same reason, fuck it. One of them will catch fire, hopefully. Pardon the pun, because I've just watched TLC, so that's...
Yeah, someone catched fire, definitely.
Oh, that was a weird day. That was a weird night. right, anyway, I was getting to a question by Brent Carter. You seem to have, I think you did promo thing, didn't you? A lot of the guys from the Edinburgh Wrestling School and Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum. So you're in conversation with Brent quite a lot, mostly about ECW December to Dismember. Conveniently enough, his question is, what's your favorite match from December to Dismember?
Oh, well, the Elimination Chamber. That's the Extreme Elimination Chamber. that's the best match ever, where the hero that everyone wanted, so Bobby Lashley, conquered the hero that we didn't absolutely didn't want and didn't make sense at the time for him to win the belt and become the face of that brand, which is CM Punk. Of course, who wouldn't want to pick Bobby Lashley instead of CM Punk any day of the week?
Because of that, we got Vince McMahon with his do-rag as ECW champion, so it all worked out well at the end.
Yeah. the balance in the force has been restored, let's say.
Oh, man, that what a time. Matthew, who again you've interviewed, with all these big names, he did a blog going through each episode of ECW on Sci-Fi, and that time it was a very interesting, strange world, especially you had Big Show versus Ric Flair, Ric Flair getting chokeslammed into thumbtacks, and Batista and Big Show getting just booed out the building. They're both told to just fuck off, just get out of here.
If I can say just one thing about the WWE version of the ECW, is that I saw the first episode when it came out, and I marked out for the zombie. I marked the fuck out for the zombie when I saw it. That's the greatest thing ever, a zombie wrestler, amazing.
It was a time. I'll say that.
I don't know, Brent, if that answers your question, but yeah, the ECW zombie was the best.
Oh man, I mean, it gave us great. I mean, what was it Macho Libre came out the week after as well, which was just a fat guy dressed as Nacho Libre and did Macho Man impressions. You know what? I loved ECW.
Yeah.
The WWE version. I didn't like that crap hardcore stuff. Give me
the real one.
give me 100-year-old Ric Flair bleeding. That's what I needed in my life. So for your UK, your European wrestling, you said you did a bit of research when you were expanding your horizons from doing the reviews podcast. You've made mention of WCPW in the past, if I mind right.
Defiant. Yeah.
Was that kind of your introduction to British wrestling or European wrestling? Where was your interest?
Absolutely. I started following the What Culture channel like in 2015, which I think it's more or less the same time that I started putting out videos on YouTube. Oh, that's an interesting story. You want to know how did I found out about What Culture?
Tell me. I was super bored
at work and didn't give a crap about what I was supposed to do that day. And I was thinking to myself, oh, I really want to know more about Jurassic World, because it was coming out in theaters during that time, more or less. So let me see if there are some, I don't know, some rumors or something, because it was immediately before that the movie came out in theater. And by researching Jurassic World, the first website that appeared on Google was What Culture. To this day, I still don't know why, but good, great SEO position. But basically through that, I discovered that What Culture talked about wrestling. I was like, oh, cool, I like wrestling. And they just launched the YouTube channel. At that time, they didn't have voiceover. Their YouTube was just images, like a carousel or something like that. I don't know if you've ever watched one of those early videos.
They're just slideshows and came up in the bottom kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And then they started doing the voiceovers later, like 2 or 3 months later. That was my first introduction when they started WCPW. That literally was my introduction, not only to the UK scene, but to indie wrestling in general. I don't recall seeing any clip or video or anything from indie wrestling even before that, because we don't have a lot of indie wrestling here in Italy. Actually, it's really close to zero, and it's specifically in the northern part of Italy, around Milan. Luca De Pazzi comes from that area. Jockey comes from that area. Akira, which I had the chance to interview and is now in All Japan Pro Wrestling, he comes from that area of Italy. That's not by accident. That's because literally one of the few places where you can train and properly go even see a show with your friends. There is something around Rome, but it's kind of a smaller in comparison. And historically wise, there is more history in the northern part of Italy about wrestling than the southern part. So I never saw independent wrestling before. And with WCPW, I was totally blown away from the first episode. I was hooked. I think at the beginning, they had the show each Tuesday. And every Tuesday, I was there watching it live on YouTube. So much so that 1 year later, I decided to go to the UK specifically to see a WCPW show. And little did I know, that was the biggest show in their history in some place near Manchester. It's quite kind of difficult to pronounce. In that show, they had Jim Cornette on commentary. They had Bret Hart. They had Kurt Angle and Cody Rhodes main eventing one against each other. That's an incredible. And the opener was a tag match involving the Mustache Mountain. Tyler Bate was 17, like turning 18 that year. And I'm now so grateful that I had the chance to see those talents immediately before they really boomed with WWE. Pete Dunne was on the shows of WCPW, and everybody mocked him because he kind of looked like Jack Swagger. So
singlet and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. The singlet, and even the hairstyle was pretty similar at the time. And the people chanted "Cheap Jack Swagger" at him, like "Cheap Jack Swagger," you know, this kind of stuff. And he did it. If go check it on YouTube because it's still there. He did it, sometimes. He did like "We the People," like Jack Swagger, just to counter that chant. I would say definitely that was my introduction, and that's why I also like wanted to follow the careers of many of the wrestlers that were prominent in that promotion. One of which is the guy that you have on your shirt, Joe Hendry. So that's why I followed this career, and I really, really wanted to interview him. That was one of the interviews that I'm more proud of at the moment.
Absolutely. It's just one of those super charismatic guys. But just finishing off WCPW stuff, not WCW,
yes.
that's where we started, WCPW stuff. So you saw the indie guys before they were in NXT UK and that. Was there any particular favorites? Didn't have to be ones that went on to be a big name. Maybe I was going to say Joseph Connors, but that seems really mean to Joseph Connors when I say like that. But guys that might not be on as many people's radars, was there anyone that caught your eye?
There is one guy called Liam Slater that I actually didn't hear of afterwards. I saw him on Twitter. I think he's like a personal trainer at the moment. I don't think he wrestles anymore. But he was in a tag team with Johnny Moss. Johnny Moss at the moment is a veteran of the UK indie scene that I think you may be familiar with him. And Johnny Moss is now one of the trainers at NXT America. He is one of the head trainers there. And he was in a tag team with this guy called Liam Slater. He had a sort of a mini push more than mini. He had a push, a proper push in WCPW. He defeated Zack Sabre Jr. Just to give you an impression of what they were trying to build this guy. And I think he got injured and missed like most of the second part of the life of WCPW when they rebranded as Defiant. I think he got lost in the shuffle afterwards. I have no idea if he still wrestles. So do you? Do you know?
As far as I'm aware, he did a couple of shows up in Edinburgh for Discovery. I know that. I think he did a little bit of Target possibly. But he, when Johnny Boss went to America, Liam Slater picked up the school here. I think that's what happened. I could be totally wrong. I could just be hearing whispers and what have you, but I'm thinking that's what happened. So possibly that's why at the moment he's a PT, because there's no wrestling training available. We can't do it. I wouldn't do it anyway, but we can't do it because of lockdown restrictions and what have you. But that's possibly where he's playing his trade now, just training people. But yeah, I do remember seeing Liam Slater, again, Discovery, just online. And he was very, very good. He had a good match with like Shady Natras from Target. So definitely one that, definitely a good one. Yeah.
He's a very unique talent, in my opinion. There is no one I could compare his style to. Probably CM Punk is the closest, because CM Punk is another guy that he is clearly not the most muscular guy, not the flippy guy, not is a kind of an in between of many things that he is not, but he is not clearly something. And Liam Slater is kind of similar in that he is not flippy, he's not muscular, not like a mat based like Zack Sabre Jr. He doesn't do power moves, or it is kind of a mixture, but. It works out well in the end. Well, Liam Slater, if you're listening to this, consider yourself invited to the Last Minute Wrestling podcast.
So, back to your podcast, and you've spoken to quite a lot of the Scottish guys now. Yes. As I say, you did the promo videos with the younger trainees. You spoke to myself, you spoke to Luca and Jokey, who we're in shared custody of with Italy. They had Eli Bulwark as well, yes. Krieger, who you mentioned. Yep. Just for future, if you're trying to remember how to say his name, he had a t-shirt called Eye of the Krieger, and that's how I remember it. Because it was like Eye of the Tiger, Eye of the Krieger. Yes. It actually popped up on his timeline today. I think he was ripping his own t-shirts and Eye of the Krieger came up. That's how you say it. So you were really immersed into Scottish wrestling. Brody Adler's got a question, which I think you've pretty much answered, but still want to give her a bit of a shout for it. So she said, being based in Italy, what brought about your passion for the Scottish scene in particular, and do you have any favourite Scottish matches?
Well, the passion for the Scottish scene, as I said, I had the chance to start right from the bat with Luca De Pazzi and you, so that was what got me into. I discovered also that the Scottish scene is particularly not only passionate, but also given you guys were the first one who actually gave me a chance. I mean, that means a lot for me because I wouldn't imagine to have an audience at all. So to see, especially when you start the podcast, to see even one guy, just one, that is invested in what you're doing, that tells you, okay, you're great, keep on doing that. Even if it's not true, I don't care. That is the biggest boost that you'll ever need. And I got that from a lot of people from the Scottish wrestling scene, probably because you are also very well connected, and I didn't figure out at the time, but I do now, that a lot of the younger talents, especially the up-and-comers, they rely a lot on your work, on the work that you do with your blog. That's I think, a great compliment for you, because that's a great thing that you're doing, a great service, public service, that could potentially launch careers in the future. So Bravo, Billy. And she also asked me about the
any favorite matches in particular.
Any favorite matches? No, I wouldn't say favorite one. There are a few that comes to mind that I saw recently. I recently saw a barbed wire ring or something like that. But I don't remember the name, but it was the ropes. The ropes were like with barbed wire between Jack Jester and Drew Galloway, McIntyre, from, I think, I don't know, probably an ICW show of like 5 years ago or something like that.
Yeah, I think it was Drew's last match in ICW, I think, if I remember right.
Okay. That was a bloodbath. And I never saw Drew doing those kind of matches. And that was, well, that really, it was so different from what you see Drew McIntyre doing normally. So, well, that's that. I don't know if that answers her question, but it's the first match that comes to my mind at this moment.
That's great. So, speaking about wrestling again, Ricky Dodgerson's got a question. I'm just kidding, because you got a lot of questions. It's really great to see that a lot of Scottish guys as well. So we're all interested. Yeah. We're all wanting to know more. But thank you for the compliment.
As I said, you guys are so giving. It's me that I have to thank you. Thank you so much, guys.
But thank you for the comment about the site. I mean, I've run the blog since 2012, and it's not that I don't get compliments. I do, but it's just I don't know how to take. I never know how to take them. I'm just like,
oh yeah, likewise.
I just did it because I was bored. And I'm now speaking to people on Zoom. Anyway, right, yeah. Ricky Dodgerson, he asks, would you ever consider commentary, and is there a dream match you'd like to call?
That's a great question, which I'm sure I reply to him like this way, but, oh yeah. Yeah, I actually, one of my goals at the moment is to do commentary. Yeah, I would love to. But I have no idea about the dream match. I mean, what's the scale of the dream? Do we have to think like, I don't know, a dream match could be CM Punk comes back from retirement and I do the commentary for that. But that's, I don't know, that's a way too much. If I have to keep it doable one way or another, I would say I could do some commentary, maybe in English, maybe in Italian, for a European promotion. I would love to. There is a match that I have in my mind, and I can't wait. I can't wait for it to happen. I don't even know if that match will ever happen. But the match is Speedball Mike Bailey versus Francesco Akira, the Italian guy that I mentioned that now is in All Japan. They both have an incredible amount of respect for each other. Akira is super young, and he's a huge Speedball Bailey fan. I think, and those two guys are super humble and super disciplined in what they do. In training, inside the ring, and stuff like that. And I think a match between those two could be literally blowing the roof off. And I would love to see that match. And since I know that the people from Rising Sun in Italy, hi Fabio, the people from Rising Sun in Italy would absolutely love to book Speedball Bailey, I will say, Fabio, you coward, book Frank Mandolini to be on commentary that night for that match. Do it, you fucking coward.
Taking full advantage of the explicit tag. There we
That's
go.
It.
but yeah, it's just one of those, it's like, sorry, my hands are all over the place for those watching the video, because I just watched Steve Austin's Broken Skull Sessions with Drew, and Steve Austin's a big hand talker, and I feel like I end up doing that as well when I'm speaking. But yeah, it's good to be able to think of a match that you'll have a little bit more backstory for in your brain, in your mind, because you'd be like, oh, he's against his idol, against someone who he admires, and then you'd be able to tell that backstory. So great choice. I mean, I've seen Speedball, I haven't seen Akira, but like, if you have the passion and the story for it, then the match will just tell its own story, kind of thing. And that is exactly how you answered the question when Ricky asked it. They said, "Great question," was your reply. I am that
predictable.
Adam asked, at the Adam Dyer, he asked, "How did you get such a winning smile?"
Oh, yeah. And as I answered, there's a nice story to it. First of all, Adam was the second person to follow me on Twitter. I don't know how the hell he stumbled on my show. And remember before when I said you just need one person to really believe in you? He was not the one, because I was fortunate enough to have at least two since the very beginning. Adam was the one that for no reason whatsoever decided to follow me. And he doesn't follow a lot of people, so I feel particularly privileged to be in his thoughts. And he also messaged me. He has a website, and he puts like a little banner that with a link to my to my podcast, and I appreciated the hell lot about it, because it was super kind. And that was literally one of the things that he did immediately from the start. And can you imagine how much confidence that gave me? That was incredible. Thank you, Adam. Thank you so much. If people do those really random acts of kindness, trust me, they go a long way. So what was his question again? Because I forgot.
The smile. Yes, that's it.
The smile. Yeah. The story of the smile starts basically with me absolutely coping the shit out of Chris Van Vliet. Because I started studying him. I was watching his interviews. He's amazing. He does really an incredible work. Everybody knows Chris Van Vliet, of course. It doesn't need no introduction from me. But I noticed one thing, that he was constantly smiling. When he asks one question, when the other person replies, he is always like that. And I understood.
That's a screenshot, by the way. That's the one I'm taking.
Yeah. Let me take this off. So you see better my wonderful t-shirt that you can buy on my website, lmwpodcast.com. So basically, it was like that. Okay, I did it for 3 seconds. And basically, that's why, because that's the, as you said, the screenshot that you can use for your thumbnails for YouTube videos. And that's very important to have. And you know what's difficult? To have a screenshot where both you and your interviewee are both smiling. That's the most difficult thing to get. So I started smiling basically every minute of every interview. At the end of each interview, my jaw is hurting because I smile too much. I don't know how Chris does it. It's amazing. He's doing it so naturally.
I would do that, but I smashed my face very young when I thought I could do wheelies on a bike, and my teeth were crooked to fuck. So I'm just like, I think I'm smiling, but then when I look back at pictures, I'm looking, what, are you ever happy? But I was like, I remember smiling at that point. I definitely smiled. I'm just like going, but I just looked fucked off the whole time. But it's also a really great way of make people at ease as well. Because, I mean, this is only our second actual vocal chat back and forth, and we've gone over an hour already. And probably just about. And we're just, and all we've done is just smile and speak wrestling. And I think if we were both looking angry and annoyed, I don't think we would reach an hour quite as simply. Yeah. But yeah, Adam, I was trying to find his website. I can't find it, but you're definitely one of his 68 people he follows. So
You see, he doesn't follow a lot of people. I really don't know what he saw in me, but I am so forever thankful for this.
I mean, I get the same. You'll probably get the same as well. I mean, Chris Van Vliet, it was a name I heard of, but I'm not going to lie and say that I've seen his work. I've seen bits and pieces of like clips and that. Mm-hmm. He followed me on Twitter, and I was looking at it going, why are you following me on Twitter? I don't know why. But and then just seeing his reach, I'm like, oh my God. he's just going through a list going, podcast, click, 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 which could happen, but I'm still confused. But yeah, if anyone follows me, I'm very grateful, especially if it's like wrestlers, and I think, oh, so you must like what we're doing. It has some random ones. I had Ryback follow me for a bit. He unfollowed me after I asked him for an interview, so that was...
it was arsehole. A bummer.
So, yeah, so Ryback, fuck you. I beat him once in the chartable ratings you pointed to me in the direction of chartable, and yeah. It's addicting. It's a really addictive once you see your name on it. At one point you're like, right, where am I today? And I beat Ryback's podcast once, and I was like, yeah, fuck you, Ryback.
Yeah, just like every fucking analytics. That's why it's social media. Just like every fucking analytics, when you start looking into it, it's fucking addictive. I got addicted to Chartable through another podcaster, an Italian podcaster friend of mine. He pointed me towards that direction as well. But now I can say I'm healing. I'm not, the addiction is not over yet, but I'm getting there. I'm watching way less the analytics from Chartable.
That's what I mean. I do check once a day just to make sure I'm beating Ryback. And then I just leave it for the day. But yeah, it can be. It's very easy to be to get bogged down in the analytics, like you say. But really, you just want to enjoy what you're doing. Because I mean, speaking of your guests, I mean, I'm wearing the Joe Hendry T-shirt. That was a huge get, especially when you watch WCPW growing up. But when you watch WCW, he was of course he grew in that company I think he would say himself WCPW was a really important time for him to grow. What was it like speaking to Joe? I mean, you can hear the interview if people are wanting to listen. They should. It's a really great interview. But was there any nerves, or were you just like, oh, it's just another day, I've got no notes, fuck it, I'm going to speak to Joe Hendry for a bit?
I had no notes as usual. That was, if I am not mistaken, that was the first interview I did through a PR. Because for the aspiring podcasters listening to us, when you interview someone signed to a big company, you usually don't go just blind tagging them on Twitter saying, hey, can you come to my show? Well, I did that to Rob Van Dam and it worked, but that's another story. Basically because Rob Van Dam doesn't give a fuck. So that's why that worked. But for an up-and-comer like Joe, it may not work. So you have to ask permission to the company. If you want to interview the WWE champion, you have to ask the WWE. You don't just tag him on the post. Same thing with Joe. It was the first time that I asked the RH for an interview, and I said, first of all, that's an advice I would like to give to everybody. Whenever you approach somebody, it doesn't have to be only wrestling. Make sure to be as professional as possible. And also make sure to be respectful. And the most important thing is to reach out via email, not DM, not blind tagging on social media. Email, old-fashioned email. That works better. People will take you more seriously if you do that. And I was very professional with with both the PR person that I spoke to and Joe in the leading up to our conversation. I was very respectful. I always tend to say, how long will I go? Because many podcasts are going for hours. And maybe when you interview someone who is a very busy person because of his work, of his position, that person may not have that much time. So I always tend to say that in advance. I say, okay, generally my interviews are like 30 to 40 minutes. And the PR guy was fantastic. Joe replied to me when we set up the interview. He replied to me saying, okay, you got 30 minutes. Was like, so off from the start, I was like, okay, I have to keep it very concise, very professional, very straight to the point. But that's like many things in life. That's the key ingredient. When you work hard and you're good at what you do because of the hard work that you put in, you get rewarded. If you listen back to our interview, there is a moment where Joe says, oh yeah, I know we said 30 minutes, but we can go 10 minutes longer. That's the most beautiful part of the interview, if you ask me. I mean, people will not care, but when you have a professional like he is enjoying, he was enjoying our chat so much so that he said, okay, I give you 10 more minutes. That was the greatest satisfaction, professionally speaking, that I could have.
Yeah, I mean, I've had the absolute pleasure of meeting Joe at shows before, and you hear my own podcast with Dave Conrad, and he's always hustling. He's very much, he knows what he wants and he's going to do what he can to get it. But last time I saw him was in Aberdeen, and I just went up to him and went, well, I didn't have any money on me, so I couldn't buy anything. But I was just like, I really enjoy your podcast. Can I get a picture? And he went, generally, you have to buy something to get a picture, but you listen to my podcast. Come here. So I was like, yes. Thank you. But so, yeah, Joe Henry is one of those guys. I'm not saying I discovered him, because I definitely did not. But when he first started, he had the music background, and he was always so confident. He was definitely one of those guys. If anyone goes back to my tweets, four or five years ago, I definitely pegged Joe Henry as one to be one to watch. So Ian Skinner, you've got a lot to live up to. If Joe Henry was one that I've picked in the past. That's the thing that kind of scares me about the I don't think I'm quite ready for doing that. I mean, I'm sure if I contacted PR for ROH and I got an interview with Joe, I would make it work. I would do half an hour or 40 minutes, mm-hmm. be perfect. But I feel like I'm still kind of building up to that. I mean, just now, before we started, behind the curtain, I said to Frank that I'll usually go about 30 minutes, about an hour usually, and we have screamed past that quite quickly. So yeah. I'm just like sitting down and chatting, and that's just how it turns out, and that's just how it goes.
That's just the nature of the podcast. It's not every podcast has to be that strict or that professional. That's more of a conversation. We could have the same conversation in front of a beer at the pub.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what I'm trying to make the entitled bit anyway. It's just a casual conversation. Some only last about 45 minutes. I've had ones that last 2 hours already. We just end up speaking and then we looked at the time and went, shit, I've got to go home, or we're already at home, but you know what I mean. Of your podcasts, you've done over 40 episodes now. You've had a wide array of guests. You say yourself, you're one of the first only podcasts to speak about the business of podcasting, of business of wrestling. So you've spoken to fight execs, Mafia of Botchamania. You spoke to Joe. You've spoken to a wide array of people. Is that a way of just keeping your interest? And it's like just keeping everything so wide in the subject matter of wrestling.
Yeah. I want to be as original as possible. I mean, it's full of wrestling podcasts that are just doing what I was doing at the beginning, like reviewing Raw, SmackDown, WrestleMania, pay-per-views, or stuff like that. There's so much, so many podcasts that are already doing that. That's one of the main reasons I steered away from that. And I didn't want to be like the guy asking the wrestlers typical podcast questions, like what's your favorite match? Who's your favorite wrestler? What's your favorite move? Or this kind of stuff. I mean, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong in doing that. Just I don't want to do that. That's it. And I found out that there is a pretty interesting niche about the business side of wrestling, which not all my episodes are about that, but some of them are more than the others. That's a niche that I'm particularly interested in because, as I said multiple times in this conversation, that's what I do for a living, basically, working in communication, which means marketing, which means analyzing data, which means doing this kind of stuff. The wrestling industry makes billions of profits all over the world each year. So it's clearly a huge business. The WWE YouTube channel is the third or fourth, if I'm not mistaken, most viewed YouTube channel. That's an incredible accomplishment. YouTube is bigger than Google. I mean, I know that YouTube belongs to Google, but YouTube is now the biggest search engine in the world. People go there before going to search something on Google. That's amazing. And if something that relates to wrestling is number three on that mammoth of a search engine, that's incredible. That's clearly some business in it. That's why I wanted to, and I don't see a lot of podcasts about that part. I think I'm still trying to find my foot, because it's not that easy. Generally, the more, I would say, hardcore business episodes that I do don't fare as well as the interviews with the more well-known wrestlers. But that's just normal. Even if you don't know anything about wrestling, but you see, like, those two episodes from the same podcast. One is Rob Van Dam, which you may have heard of, because even if you don't know about wrestling...
You never mention it. I think you should mention it more.
No. I mean, but it's just for example, because it's a mainstream name. It's not only about wrestling. Even my dad knows nothing about wrestling, but he has heard the name Rob Van Dam. You know what I mean? Or for example, Kim Hurwitz, which is the CMO at Fight TV. Of course, people go towards the name that they already may have heard of. But in my opinion, of course, from a strictly a business standpoint, is more interesting to know about Fight TV than about even a legend of the ring, as Rob Van Dam is. Of course, if we're talking about the wrestling standpoint, it's the other way around. So that's why it's difficult to find a perfect balance with those two words that are so connected one to the other, but it's difficult to find the right amount of business inside of wrestling and vice versa.
Yeah, I mean, the wrestling business itself, you said it's a multi-billion dollar business, and
yeah,
everyone's wanting a little piece of the pie and can only have so much. But within that, there's niches and niches and niches of niches. And yes. I mean, my podcast, it's Scottish wrestling. And it's not just Scottish wrestling. It's not your big names. It's not your Piper Nivens. It's not your Kaylee Rays. It's your guys that you're going to go and see all year round show that's maybe just filling out the roster, or maybe a guy like or even a guy like Kuma, who is is bigger in Europe, but he's not going to be in your first 10 names of wrestlers that you could think of. So it's all about finding that balance, I suppose. And I mean, my listening figures, some of them are fantastic, some are just not as great, but for me, I'm still enjoying it. So as long as people are giving it a chance, at least for a couple of minutes out of their day, then I'll keep pestering wrestlers until they tell me to stop. I've got one more question from the Twitter sphere, to make sure I definitely got it, which I think you probably I've left it to last because it's quite a big one. It's a little bit about music as well, which I know you've spoken about it in your interview with the guys from Ringsiders when you're all about Frank episode, was it? To be Frank episode. So I didn't want to delve into that because I would be lost very quickly. But Wrestling with the MMA has asked, if you had one book, one CD, one movie, and one food for the rest of your days, what are they?
Okay, so one book is probably, again, depends on what genre, but let's say one book is probably For Whom the Bell Tolls, from Ernest Hemingway. One movie is La La Land. Love it, absolutely love it. What was that? One CD as well?
CD, yeah.
One CD, that gets complicated. One CD, fuck it. London Calling by The Clash. I don't know. For sure, one of the CDs I've heard the most in my entire life, but at the moment is the first one that came to mind. One food. Wrestling with the MMA that asked this question is the other guy that from the start followed me and gave me a lot of confidence. So thank you so much, man. I love you. I love you to death. But you know, I'm Italian. I cannot choose between just one food. There's just so many. Just so many. I don't know, pizza, tortellini, pasta, stoccafisso. There's so many. It's very difficult. Very difficult. Let's say pizza.
Classic. It's classic.
Yeah.
I mean, I was looking through that thinking one book, if I was on an island, how to build a boat. But I would probably go, I mean, you haven't asked me wrestling with MMA, but I'm going to answer them anyway. So I've got one book. It's Mark Haddon's A Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime. It's about autistic. It's from the point of view of a boy with autism and Asperger's. Okay. On the spectrum. Okay. My brother's got autism, so it kind of speaks to me a little bit. It's very weird. The chapter numbers are prime numbers, and it's written as he thinks. It's really good. It's a strange book. A lot of people can't get into it, but it's worth a read. I was the only book I think I've read multiple times because I like watching videos instead. One movie. I'm a big superhero nerd, I think I'm just going to go Deadpool because I know it's one I could put on anytime. Deadpool, that's the one.
Amazing.
I think most of my color scheme of stuff is red and black now because of it. even my headphones. Have you got the little Deadpool tattoo for those that are on the video?
Oh, that's cool. I didn't notice that.
One food. I mean, you had the problem being an Italian. I'm a Scotsman. We'll eat anything. I'm going to go pizza as well. Pizza's, it's adaptable. Pizza's fine. What was it? CD. I listen to podcasts. I don't listen to as much music anymore. Even when I do listen to music, it's absolute shit. It's like early 2000s pop. It's so bad. It's good. Steps and NSYNC and all that shit I listen to now because I'm 30 and I don't give a fuck. But I'm gonna go, which isn't that. It's Good Charlotte's Young and the Hopeless, because okay. It was when I was going through my teenage angst years, which was just listening to Good Charlotte. That was pretty much as far as I got with the angst. I didn't do the running away and smoking or drinking in the park or anything like that.
That sounds terrible.
To a lot of people, it is. But yeah, so while you're enjoying La La Land, I'll be listening to middle-class boys playing in their garage speaking about how hard their life is. But I think that's a great way to round off the podcast, just sort of a little bit of fun non-wrestling related. Otherwise, I think we're going to end up trying to fix the wrestling business for the rest of the evening. So I don't think we should press on. We'll get part two possibly in the future. But
yeah, why not?
Thank you for taking the time to speak to me, Frank. Thank you for returning the favour after you put up with me back in, was it June, May, June time? Something, April? I have no idea.
I think it was April.
Oh, God, that's when... April. That was only a month in to the pandemic. It's been so long. But yeah, thank you for joining me. I'm so look forward to chatting again. But for anyone who's aware or who wants to know more about you, I know you've got all the links handy. Where can people find you?
Okay. The official website of the Last Minute Wrestling Podcast is lmwpodcast.com. You can find me on all over, every social media, every goddamn social media, at lmwpodcast. But please mostly go on Twitter, because that's literally the only place where I answer. and there is a Patreon page, patreon.com/forward lmwpodcast. So far, I have only one Patreon, which is one of my best friends, is very fun. It's very fun with Patreon, because they pay you a beer, basically, and what they get is a coffee. It's, taxation, this kind of stuff. But so far, I only have one patron, and he's one of my best friends. So please, if you want to help out, go and become a patron. And most of all, you can find me in your hearts.
Before I go, you put out on Twitter one of your favorite belt designs. And yes. I just want to... Show this.
Oh, that's an absolute beaut. That's the Ruthless Aggression era WWE title. That's the most beautiful, undoubtedly the most beautiful WWE title design ever.
It's so intricate. It's even got the McMahon family seal and everything. It's amazing. Anyway, right, before we go into that subject, thank you for watching and listening to the Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN. I have been Billy. It's the first time I've had an outro, but thank you for listening. Have a good
day. Thank you for having me. Bye.